Thank Ladies you. And gentlemen, Mr. Claus Hessler, thank you for coming out to Drumeo, man.
Yeah, pleasure to be here. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. And if you guys want to know what that track was, it was a track called Inception.
Yes.
And it's a new track coming out on your album with the band Flux that
yes,
you play in and record with and
Absolutely.
All that. So that's coming out at the end of this year?
Yeah, so it should be out by October.
Very cool.
And I'm not sure if you're aware of the movie Inception, actually.
I sure am, yeah.
You do?
Yeah.
Okay. So
based on that...
It has nothing to do with that.
Okay. Very cool song though, man. Nice playing. And for you guys who don't know who Claus is, you got to check him out. Not only does he play with the band Flux, but he's a clinician. You tour and do camps all over the place. You taught drummers for the likes of like Annika Niles. You've taught her. You did a couple lessons with Benny, I believe, back in the day as well. But not only that, but you actually studied with Jim Chapin.
Yes.
And from what I remember and from what I've read, he said, is on the record saying that of all the students who picked up the molar technique and my teachings the most, it was you, which is a pretty high accolade.
It is. And it's a great honor for me to have a statement like that from such a legend as Jim really was. Yeah.
No totally. Doubt. You guys can follow Claus all obviously online. ClausHessler.com is his website. You can find him on Facebook at Claus Hessler Official. I believe Twitter is just at Claus Hessler and Instagram Claus_Hessler. If you guys want to follow him on social media, you're always doing something new. You're always doing a new camp or clinic. So definitely check him out. And if you get a chance to go and see him live, absolutely, because his playing is unbelievable, as you just saw there. Another cool thing about you as a drummer is you're an open-handed drummer. And
yeah,
that is not a lot of drummers do that. And I know a lot of students of ours are always asking for open-handed lessons. You actually even have a book series, volume 1 and 2, on open-handed playing. And you can find those, obviously, on his website. You can find them where else online?
Well, pretty much everywhere on Planet Drums. So wherever you go, it should be available internationally with Alfred Publishing and Wisdom Media. It's co-written with my other important mentor, Dom Famularo.
That's right.
I should mention. Yeah.
That's right, absolutely. You have a DVD out as well?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
What does this DVD cover?
It's mostly, say, molar technique through the Chapin lenses. So I always wanted to have something out which really describes molar technique through the eyes of Mola's master student, Jim Chapin. Mm-hmm. So it's more or less a filmed book, say. It comes with an extensive PDF of 120 pages, something.
Okay, yeah.
But it's mostly molar through the Chapin glasses, yeah.
Love it. Check these out, everyone. And we're gonna be giving these away too. We're gonna have three packs of both volume one, volume two of Open Handed Playing, as well as this DVD. And we're gonna give those out very simply by leaving a comment. Once this lesson hits YouTube, just leave a comment below saying what your favorite part of this lesson was. And within 30 days of us uploading the lesson, we will choose three lucky winners and we'll send you out a Claus Hessler prize pack, I guess you can call it. You also created a book, which is called Camp Duty Update. Now this is a book completely in German right now, but you have it coming out by the end of this year, end of 2016, it'll be in English as well. Tell us a little bit about this book.
Well, it's mostly about the rich, say, rudimental heritage of what we do as drummers. So it covers rudimental history and the say European roots of the foundation of our art form, playing the drums, and so it covers the history as well. It also covers say classic rudimental tunes taken from the camp and garrison duty, hence the name, Camp Duty Update.
Very cool.
And so it's also a play along book because all these ancient marches and drum beatings, they all came with a melody played from the fife. And so you can play along these tunes in their original versions with the fife, but I also added like updated modern versions, hence update. Mm-hmm. Modern versions that make use of Swiss rudiments and collapsed rudiments as well. So they are, some of them are pretty freaking hard, I should say. But still, you can play along with them and fine-tune your technique and understand collapsed rudiments, get a little insight to Swiss rudiments, and complete that puzzle of playing the drums. Yeah.
Love it, man. Yeah. Very, very well-respected educator. If you guys haven't heard of him, go and check him out online. And also, a huge thanks to Mapex and Sabian and Vic Firth and Evans for helping bring you out here. It's a beautiful Mapex kit, as you can see. Thanks, Otto and Dave, for helping us out with that. And awesome-sounding cymbals, too. So huge thanks to the sponsors there for helping us out. And the cool thing about all what we just talked about with all your teachings and all your books and stuff is you're going to share a little bit of insight on that with this lesson called Collapsed Rudiments and Applications. Like, what does that even mean?
Well, collapsed rudiments, I mean, I should maybe start out with, or I maybe leave out what rudiments really are, because I think most of us know what rudiments are.
Yeah, I would say so, yeah.
I would think so. Now, with collapsed rudiments, it's more or less a strategy that that was one of the favorite playgrounds of Chapin. And so it's really his idea where I'm taking on. And it's all about changing the distances between the notes of a pattern. So so you if you collapse a rudiment, you would close the distance between two strokes. If you uncollapse the distance, you make that distance wider. Mm-hmm. The only rule pretty much is that that you never fool around with the sticking in terms of you never change the order of right and left strokes. So if it's right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left, it will still stay in that structure, but the distances between the notes are different. And it's kind of interesting to see how modern certain approaches, especially if you apply them to the, if you put them to the drums, how modern that sounds. And it gives you like a different and fresh look on one of the all-time favorite issues, which is rudiments,
yeah.
Of course.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I'm excited to get into it. Before we do, guys, if you like what you see here, we do this all the time on Drumeo every day. And you can sign up for a membership, drumeo.com. We're also doing a couple exclusive courses with Klaus on open-handed drumming and Swiss rudiments. So definitely sign up if you want to check those out. We're also doing a Q&A tomorrow for all you guys watching live who don't get your questions answered today because we always have too many to answer. So we always do a Q&A for Edge members tomorrow. So definitely sign up and come see us tomorrow if that's what you want to do. But enough of me talking. I'm going to give it to you. Take it away, Klaus. What is collapsed rudiments and how do you apply them to your kit?
Okay. So first of all, I would like to put out some bait for you before we get into the real tricky stuff, just to make you see how effective and how useful that can be. So I would like to start with a favorite pattern of Jim that is based on a paradiddle-diddle. And of course, the paradiddle-diddle, no big secret to that, it's... right, left, right, right, left, left. And that's like on your sheet, on the PDF that comes with the lesson, it's number 3. So when you see that, number 3, The first section, which is notated in 6/16, because it has six positions. That would be the regular paradiddle-diddle, but now when I collapse in terms of, I do something about the distance between the first and the second double stroke, and I make that distance a flam.
Oh, I see.
So that's what it's finally about. The interesting thing is that in your head and in your imagination and in the way how you understand the pattern, you still play the paradiddle-diddle.
Gotcha.
But you lose one position, which finally makes that. Out of. So you still see it's right, left, right, right, left, left. But since you make that one distance a flam, you lose one rhythmic position. So let's say you would understand that as a, you understand the 5/16 thing as a quintuplet. Mm-hmm. You could come up with something like that. Instance.
Yeah.
So the interesting thing is that even with a pattern like that, that has kind of a simple structure, say, simple because the leading hand never changes and there's only one hand that has accents, you can still create some interesting drum set vocabulary. Now imagine I would use what Joe Morello was referring to as flat flams, not playing flams in terms of blah at two notes at a slightly different time, mm-hmm. but at the same time. Mm-hmm. And I would fool around on the drum set, you would possibly get something like this out of this collapsed paradiddle-diddle. Check this out. And so forth. I mean, it's really a nice kind of playground that you can use, and it's very helpful if you want to create certain melodies around the drum kit by orchestrating or by giving one hand a certain system of orchestration. Let's say, mm-hmm. Is that clear so far?
I
think it is.
Yeah.
Now the other interesting thing is you can also use that five note grouping, of course, as if it would be a quintuplet. That's one thing, which yeah. is very hip these days.
Yeah.
I mean, just as Annika. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
You might also want to use it as a group of just five notes, either in 16th or 32nd note background, and make it a fill. So, for instance, think of something like that. That would be the five note grouping.
Mm-hmm.
If you think of the 16th note thing, imagine. which creates something else. Mm-hmm. Plus, you might even notice that there are some old friends inside the pattern. For instance, like the first bar of it, of that collapsed paradiddle diddle, finally creates a pattern on your right hand, which is by accident the same as the cascara pattern. So the cascara is something that you have quite frequently in Cuban music.
Yeah.
But most people really don't think of it as a five note grouping, which it really is. So it would just as well fit in a context like that if you want to place ghost notes around the cascara phrase, although the cascara would come with different accents. Mm-hmm. So cascara would be this. For instance, now with the collapsed paradiddle, it would be. As the ongoing loop, you don't hear the cascara anymore, but if you loop it after one bar, you get like this. So that kind of fits nicely into that Cuban corner of the world. Mm-hmm. And it's all based on the paradiddle diddle, which is.
So when you practice it, are you thinking paradiddle diddle? Because it feels like a different rudiment because you're putting them so close together. So is it just like learning a whole new pattern, or do you think about it as a paradiddle diddle?
I think if you have some playing routine and some experience with the paradiddle diddle, it doesn't feel that strange. It's pretty much the same thing, I would say. And technically speaking, you're using the same tools. It's the same sticking. You're just doing something about the distance between the notes. Mm-hmm. So that pretty much is the secret. And although that's not on paper, if you would collapse one more position out of the paradiddle diddle, you would end up creating yet another rudiment, which then exists already, which would be the pada fla fla.
That's right.
So the pada fla fla and the paradiddle diddle share the same sticking. It's different as far as the dynamics go, but if you ever wondered why your pada fla fla might be a little weak, it might be your paradiddle diddle is also a little weak or weaker than you thought.
Interesting.
So seeing all that stuff behind the curtain is kind of interesting. Because you suddenly create a different relation between the rudiments and between the fundamentals of our art form. And on the other hand, you can create new rudiments like this collapsed five-note paradiddle diddle, which is a totally different rudiment that nobody played before. There's no name for it. It doesn't appear in any list. Mm-hmm. So that's really exciting to create new rudiments based on old ones. And you even use the same tools on the new rudiments as on the old ones. So that's kind of interesting.
Love it. So good. What are some other collapse rudiments that you use?
So let's look into a double drag tap, for instance. So the double drag tap, that's a very old rudiment. And played on a snare would be this. Pretty much that. So it's example 4A, yeah, I should mention.
It's all good.
And it's the double drag tap in the US. The French relate to it in traditional French rudimental drumming. It's called the Dian, usually in connection with a 9-stroke roll, but it's part of the Dian. And in Swiss drumming, it's called a Tagwachtstreich, which means a reveille stroke, would you say? I mean, like a signal to wake up troops. That was something played in the morning to wake up a city or troops or soldiers or a garrison. And as you see, I have a kind of unusual notation using the quintuplet structure, but that is actually very close to how you really phrase it in reality. So if you imagine the quintuplets and then the double drag tap, just to make you understand the background, would sound like so. Check this out. So
that's great.
Actually, quite obvious that it's very natural. It falls very natural on that grid of quintuplets. And if I would not have mentioned it, nobody would have said, "Oh, that sounds weird," or "It sounds like quintuplets." And the French really teach that rudiment this way. Yeah. Now, of course, you can fool around with that pattern in itself to a certain degree, but. But now let's maybe look into the opposite thing of collapsing a rudiment in terms of uncollapsing it, and that would be example 4b, finally. And as you see, the structure of the sticking is the same. It's right, left, left, right, left, right, right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left. So I will play 4a and 4b in a sequence for you, so you notice how close they are related. So check this out.
I can see that.
Okay. Yeah. So the interesting thing about that and the true benefit about that is that usually if you want to try to play septuplets, you're almost happy if you make it to seven strokes and not eight and not six, and usually you're happy if you make it like an alternating right left sticking. Yeah. But here with the background of the rudiment, you manage to play dynamics inside the pattern, and we're talking about a relatively complex structure of a sticking, which if you approach that without the background of the double drag tap is kind of hard to get into. Mm-hmm. But if you still have the double drag ticking in your head and you have some experience with that rudimental pattern, it's kind of easy to get into the septuplet thing. Yeah. And to uncollapse the notes of that pattern. So again, here you have some interesting things happening if you put that on the drums. And in the intro of that song, Inception, I was using a little bit of that phrase, actually, which I'll show you in a second again. But if I use that example 4b now on just between hi-hat and snare, you already get something interesting. So check this out. This is 4b, just between hi-hat and snare. The only thing I'm doing is I'm exchanging right and left since I'm playing it open-handed, but that's my problem, possibly not yours. So
okay, yeah.
Your choice. Okay. So again, interesting. If what I did in the intro of the song was that here, check this out. I was only using that between the bell and between the aluminum bell and the cowbell.
Yeah.
And you might also create interesting fills if you use that seven note grouping. Not as a septuplet or not as a 7/8 structure, but you could use it as a group of seven in 32nd notes.
Let's see how that sounds.
So imagine the 32nd or the 16th would be.
Mm-hmm. Just like that.
Just like that.
Just like
and, and the interesting thing about that is that on the one hand, we have a very old rudiment. I mean, you can trace that pattern back a couple of hundred years.
Yeah.
Actually. And just by doing something about the distances between the notes, you can make it like a super hip thing, which doesn't sound like...
Doesn't sound traditional at all.
1700s or,
yeah, exactly.
or 1600s, yeah. I should say. And that's really something surprising, I think. And so when I said collapsed rudiments is something that can give you like a fresh and different look on rudiments, that's really something that this here does. And and especially with patterns like double drag tap, I mean, if you don't do something about the distances between the notes, you can just play the rudiment in a Charlie Wilcoxon or whatever.
Yeah, I always found that one of the hardest rudiments to apply to the kit. It's so rudimental, so military-esque, I found.
Yeah.
Very cool. So what else? What else do you have? It's 4C. Is that the same? Is that the same rudiment? Is that still the double drag tap?
It's still the double drag tap, but it's a little weird since it comes in a wild say arrangement of flams and unaccented notes. So so if you imagine, I will play 4C in connection with 4A.
Okay.
To give you an idea how it's related. So 4A again would be this. Oh, sorry. I did 4B, and you can play all the three of them in connection, and it's interesting to see how they all pretty much feel the same. It's just you do something about the distances between the notes.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So far with that.
So far, so good, man. This is great. So did you do this with all 40 rudiments? Have you experimented with collapsing and expanding all the rudiments to see what you come up with, or...?
I mean, with the rudiments that work best for that are usually any sort of roll rudiments. So, for instance, any sort of 5-stroke roll, 7-stroke roll, 6-stroke roll, whatever stroke roll, those work pretty good because they leave options to collapse or uncollapse the notes. Mm-hmm. Certain rudiments that already come with even equal distances between the notes, you pretty much cannot uncollapse because they already have even distances.
Yeah.
So you can just collapse them. So they do not have all the potential on the earth to fool around with them.
Yeah.
Yeah. So another one that is still interesting is the example 5, I should say, and that could be interesting because it's a pattern that is not in the list of 40 US rudiments. It's a Swiss rudiment, and it's called the final stroke of 7. So
okay.
it usually appears in the traditional sense at the end of a Swiss drumming verse or a basal drumming verse, I should say. So it's basal drumming in special, and of course Basel is a town in Switzerland, but there's a big difference between Swiss drumming and ordnance drumming and Swiss military drumming and basal drumming. And the difference is much bigger as you might think.
Mm-hmm.
So again, that one is based on quintuplets, and 5A should sound like this. Check this out. Should I play that at a slower pace?
I was going to say maybe show us what the original, for those who don't know this rudiment, show us what that sounds like without it being collapsed.
I mean, that is the original rudiment.
Oh, that is the original.
That is the original one.
Perfect. So B would be the one where it's...
B would be the uncollapsed version. Right, absolute, because if you look to B, you see the distances between the notes are even. All the notes have equal distance.
Very cool.
Which again has some interesting kind of flow to it, and as far as drum set applications go, it's also interesting because you can fool around with that stuff no matter if you're in straight 16th 32nd note rhythm or in any sort of ternary shuffle sort of rhythm on your way, because it doesn't interfere with any of them, so it's yeah. It has a life of its own. So you can use it in shuffled context, or you can use it in straight 16th 32nd note context, and it works or does not work. You can also see it from the other side, in both hemispheres of the drumming world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah? And then I guess C would be an even more collapsed version of that.
Absolutely. So C brings the notes closer together. So C would be in together in cooperation, say, with pattern 5A, mm-hmm. 5A, and C would be. So the cool thing about this here is it has accents and soft notes. It has accented flams and it has soft flams. Mm-hmm. So one thing that I noticed with many students is that they run into this trap of always understanding a flam as an accent, and which it is not. So
no,
absolutely not. But yeah. but that's one very common misconception about flams, that we think. They only come in one dynamic setting, so to speak, and you don't really make a difference between an accented flam or a soft flam, or in terms of what dynamic range you choose for the grace note. There should be all kinds of options that you can use. There is no such thing as only that one official setting of how you play a flam.
Yeah.
There could be much more, and there's a wealth of ideas of how you could play a flam.
Awesome. I love this stuff, man. This is opening up the doors for so many different concepts. Now, we started at number 3. Do you want to just quickly, I know we're running low on time here, but do you want to just quickly talk about the first couple exercises on the first page of this PDF that you're offering everyone?
Absolutely. So if we look a little bit into exercise 1, I should say, now with these exercises, you noticed it's mostly about the technical skill to influence the distance, say, between double strokes. Mm-hmm. How can you... How close or how wide or how open can you play the two notes of a double stroke? So that was the reason why I came up with that exercise, and that consists of eight little sequences, and you might stay inside these little sequences for as long as you wish to. Now that's taken out of an educational poster, by the way, that I put together with Dom Famularo, So you notice both hands, right and left, always have one loud and one soft stroke. So my right hand does this. All the time, on the beat. And my left hand does also this. But my left hand changes the positions. It kind of slows down while the right hand always stays in place. And that creates some interesting say combinations which look easy on paper because you think, oh boy, it's just with either hand, but that's not it. So let me show that to you. So I'm now in the first segment. I'm slowly moving into the second one. I'm moving to the third one. Now I'm moving into number four. Now we should go into the next section. Yeah, thank you so much. Now you notice my hands are playing in unison, but the soft stroke is together with the loud stroke.
Right.
If I move into the next section, sounds a little weird. And into the next section. And into the next. And back to the beginning.
That is awesome. I didn't think it would sound as cool as it did, just looking at that. And when you said it looks easy on paper, it doesn't look easy on paper, by the way.
Okay.
It looks equally as hard. But that's very cool.
Yeah, and I'm just a big fan of understanding fundamentals in the most solid and way, actually, I should say.
Yeah, that makes sense. Now, before we wrap up, what about the molar triplet circle?
Yeah.
You don't have to go through all of them. I know there's A through J, I believe, or even further.
Yeah,
sorry, A through J.
We might capture like the first four or five of them, like A, B, C, D, E, from A to E. And the interesting thing was that I've been often asked, boy, I've been working on my molar now and I got my triplets together so I can play this. But what's that any good for? Except the fact that I can do it. So I thought, boy, it's there's a lot more to it than just that, because from 2A to 2B, the structure of the up and down strokes stays the same, but I'm just doubling the third position. So 2A and 2B in sequence would be that. 2A and 2B. Back to 2A and 2B. 2A, 2B, and now let's switch to C. And all of a sudden, we have a paradiddle.
Mm-hmm.
And the funny thing is that if you see the front camera of me doing this here, you see not that much of a difference if I would play 2A or 2B or 2C. So again, it has a lot to do with understanding collapsed rudiments, because you do something about the distance between the notes and understanding, or I mean, this goes out to all of you who are teaching drums. I think there's a lot of wisdom and a lot of truth in understanding that alternating triplet before you get into something like the paradiddle, because leaving out the accent on the paradiddle and just playing, that's not a paradiddle. It's only the sticking of a paradiddle, because the accent is missing. So that should be in there to make it a complete paradiddle. And from the paradiddle, you can go and collapse one more position and make the paradiddle a flam accent. So here is 2C and 2D in sequence. Check this out. 2C and D. And back.
That's awesome.
So seeing that relationship also and understanding collapsed rudiments also does something to the method that, that you use when you're teaching rudiments and really putting a system to rudiments and their execution that, that really makes sense, mm-hmm. I guess.
I remember when I was learning the flam accent and I would, the flam tap, and I would isolate my hands. And then I realized that it's just basically almost like exactly what you're talking about, a triple stroke roll, just collapsed a little bit into each other. And it really helped me because I was able to practice my triple stroke roll, which helped my flam tap.
Absolutely.
So I guess it's all in the same kind of realm.
Absolutely, yeah.
I love the stuff.
Good one.
I mean, I'm a nerd when it comes to this anyway, so I'm going to be digging into this quite a bit deeper. But for those watching that might not, first off, that might not even know all 40 rudiments, like what would you recommend to them? Do they start with trying some collapsed rudiments? Do you recommend them learn all 40 first? Like, how would you approach this as a beginner or intermediate?
Now, for instance, that exercise or that thing that we just did with 2A and 2B and 2C, that would be a nice point to start with, because I mean, understanding a paradiddle, that's something that you usually get together, mm-hmm. and making the paradiddle a flam accent is something that you can do, I think, and same goes for making and that would be the next series of exercises. If you double the middle position of the triplet, I think that's on the paper. It should be, wait. It should, oh, I don't have it here.
If you double the middle.
It's not that one, it's the, and one more, 2G, yeah. If you double the middle note of the triplet and you make this an inverted paradiddle. That's also something very cool. So that, by the way, is also another rudiment. It's the single drag tap, actually. So it's that. But you can easily make it. So these are exercises that really make sense for I mean, not for a perfect beginner, but for someone who's looking into collapsed rudiments for the first time, I guess that makes sense. It's something that's doable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then when you hear, you apply it. I mean, it's clear the benefit to it. And applying it to the kit, I mean, you're just putting it over two different voices and hearing what you're coming up with, throwing a backbeat, and they're coming up with a beat. Yeah. And the cool thing is, it's something that's different. It's not everyone does the 40 rudiments. This is a little bit of a different approach to it.
It is, yeah.
Very cool. Do you want to play us a tune, and there may be another song from Flux while I gather some questions from the members?
Okay. Yeah, so I'll be playing something which is from taken from the last album. It's called H2O, and it's like a little more on the sophisticated side, like Inception before. That's more on the groove side of things happening, but H2O comes in 7 straight through. Has some little ostinato stuff happening also. And so it should be fun, I hope.
Awesome. Well, here we go. H2O by Flux.
Thank you.
Awesome, man. Very good stuff. I gotta check more of that Flux album out. Okay. That's great. Some questions.
Yes.
Before we wrap up.
Yeah.
Time is of the essence here, so we won't be able to get through all of them, but again, we are doing a Q&A to make sure that we get all the questions answered. We actually have one person here, and I don't know if I'm pronouncing this right, Nedj Kern says, hey Klaus, hope you're doing well. I just want to thank you for this lesson. It cleared up some things that I forgot to ask you about in Croatia. So he obviously saw you.
Okay.
but he says, thanks for the encouragement. I've been getting compliments on I've been getting compliments on my shaved head recently. You're the man. So.
Now I know who you are. I know.
You made an impact on him.
Yeah.
Very cool. Mojo Drum says, hey Klaus, could you maybe show us an example or two using a double paradiddle? How would you collapse a double paradiddle?
A double paradiddle? Well, you could, for instance, make it. Let me see. You could make it a double paradiddle. You could make it right, left. I would need a piece of paper actually to write it down.
Yeah.
But you could make. It could turn out to be a quintuplet, hand to hand with a flam on the first position. If you collapse the second the note of the double stroke towards the beginning of the paradiddle, of the double paradiddle, excuse me. Mm-hmm. So that would be, so I mean, to make a general rule out of that, the positions that are always interesting is the kind of that spot between a double stroke and the next double stroke, or between a double stroke and the next single stroke. So these are always the positions. Whenever a double stroke is somewhere in the game, it gets something interesting. So in that case would be a collapsed version of the paradiddle, the double paradiddle. Excuse me.
Very cool. Makes sense to me. Kirk asks, is there a difference between a flam and a collapsed rudiment?
Well, a flam actually is a collapsed single stroke. Mm-hmm. A collapsed single stroke roll. If you say you had single strokes in terms of that. So that already is a collapsed rudiment. You could also do it with double strokes, like. Going to a Swiss triplet, from the Swiss triplet to alternating flams. And if I'm playing against the rule, and if I fool around with the sticking, I would end up with single strokes. Check this out. Doubles. Swiss triplet. Alternating flams. And now it sounds a little weird, but check this. But now I arrive with single strokes. Hmm. So I broke the rule,
yeah.
I should say. But back to the question, a flam actually is a collapsed single stroke roll, but not with alternating sticking. So the flam would always be right, left, or always left, right, left, right.
Makes sense. Here's one from Billy Sticks. And we kind of talked about it a little bit before you started playing your song. Where do you start with Swiss rudiments?
Well, it's...
That's a large question. We're doing a whole course with Klaus on Swiss rudiments, and that's where you should start once we film it and upload it, that is. But what would you recommend for him right now?
Well, the challenge is actually that with Swiss rudiments, they have their own way of notating it. So Berger notation, for instance, is something that is you cannot read it unless you have a teacher who shows you how to read Berger notation, and you gotta have a teacher who shows it to you. So I had a couple of friends who helped me with that, and from that I drove to Basel a couple of times to see the Fastnacht and the Morgenstreich, which is amazing. And if you hear it like for the first time, it sounds like 1,000 drunken Brazilians playing Charlie Wilcoxon, because it has that strange sort of swing that you would not expect with rudimental drumming. So it's hard to answer in like two sentences, but check out the course we're doing on Swiss rudiments, and maybe check out the books by Dr. Fritz Berger. And if you let me know by email, I'll explain some of the notation by email or by Skype or whatever.
Very cool. I'm excited to see that as well. I've never really dived into that, so I'm pumped. We'll leave it there because we have a couple more questions. Some people that came in late that said, what are collapse rudiments? So you just will have to watch this lesson again once it hits YouTube or in the Drumeo archive. And for all the other questions that we won't get to today, we'll get to them tomorrow in the Q&A. Anything left to say, any last minute pieces of advice for those tackling collapse rudiments before we wrap up?
Well, the benefits are pretty clear. It gives you a different and fresh approach on rudiments. It's not like noodling around in that same dusty corner of rudiments that we have been elaborating on for the last 60 years. It's something new.
Yeah.
You can create your own rudiments. Plus, insight into that topic really teaches you about the relationship between certain rudiments that you possibly did not see before. So what is it that the pata flafla and the paradiddle-diddle have in common? Mm-hmm. Or what is it that the five-stroke roll and the single flamp mill have in common? It both share the same sticking. So understanding these relationships and noticing that it's only about the distances between the notes that make the difference, that's something that that clears a lot of that rudimental myth that we seem to have in our drumming scene. So.
Very cool. Well, thank you so much for coming out and sharing this with us, Klaus.
My pleasure.
Absolutely. We'll have to get you back. You're always welcome here at Drumeo. And for those who liked what Klaus talked about, what he kind of showed us, and even the songs that he played, you got to check him out. Just go to klaushessler.com and all the links are there. And if you want to see this Swiss rudiment course, as well as the open-handed course that we're going to be doing, or check out the Q&A for tomorrow, go to drumeo.com and sign up for an Edge membership. I think that's enough for me. You want to play us out?
Yeah, I'll be playing some...
Play us a solo, man.
A little improvised, whatever.
Take your time, have fun. Okay. I always like to go into the back room and watch it from the audience perspective. So
okay.
Have fun, take your time, and we'll see you guys all later. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.
Klaus, don't leave me hanging here live on video, man. Klaus, you're leaving me hanging, buddy.
Yeah,
leave you. Oh, there we go. Oh, that was the most awkward thing. Thank you so much, Klaus. See you guys later.
Okay. Oh, boy.